we will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is May 10th, 2015, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, SoundCloud, and the next day on Stitcher. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom. Exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we're going to talk actually a lot about that today when we talk about something that people don't usually associate with violence, but it's all backed by force and violence. But we're happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype at username Nonpartisan Liberty for all one word. And you can send a contact request with your name and what you want to talk about. And we will accept that and get you on the air. And check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which includes our links to Facebook and other social media, as well as archives and other things as well. So tonight, she usually is with us on Thursdays, but she's not able to join us this Thursday. So she's joining us tonight instead. Katy Reyes is here co-hosting.
Good evening, everyone.
And of course, thank you, Katy, for joining us.
Why, thank you.
So tonight we're going to talk all about the police regarding traffic tickets, traffic stops, and really their functionality when it comes to the roads. And the roads, of course, that can sound like a small topic, but it's really not. And it is something that can go from a small citation or something that somebody thinks of a innocent citation where you just have to pay a fine to someone ending up in jail or ending up dead, really. And the reason this had come up, well, one of the reasons it had come up is because Katy had gotten a ticket and she had messed up on the date or wasn't thought it was a different date than it was. So she had thought she had an extra month. And what happened was, and this is what they do, if you don't pay a citation within the amount of time that they give you a court date. It's kind of weird how they do it now, because from what I understand, they don't even tell you how much you owe. You have to go and look it up and find that out. and then you can go to court, which I suggest that everybody do, that they actually wait for your court date and go to court. But then if you don't go to court, you get a warrant issued for your arrest. So you could end up in jail just for not paying a ticket. And right there is where violence and force come into it right away. Because an arrest, whether you want to admit it or not, or I'm sure there's a lot of people just saying, well, if you would have just showed up for court, or you would have paid the ticket, or it's your responsibility, or some bullshit like that, that it's all on you because the government gives you a ticket for something you never agreed to anyway. When it comes down to it, as far as I'm concerned, you have the right to travel freely, although the government doesn't agree with that. But at the same time, they can pull you over, they can give you a ticket, and never mind even giving you the ticket, there's the pulling you over part as well, which we'll talk about also, but where you can end up dead from that, and a lot of people have. But there's the ticket that you don't agree to pay fines if you're given a ticket, if you're caught speeding, if you don't obey a traffic law, and you don't consent to the traffic laws. It's, you could say that, well, when you get your license, you consent to the traffic laws, but you don't have a choice. And in most places in the country, you can't live without a license. Now, I guess, yes, you could take the bus everywhere, but it's more coercion that you're forced to agree. Otherwise, you know, live without a car, and how are you supposed to get around?
Well, here were my thoughts on the whole system, because you had asked me, you know, it's backed up by force. You know, eventually, if you don't pay your tickets, you'll get arrested, you'll get kidnapped and thrown in jail. So I thought about it and I said, do most people deserve to be arrested and thrown in jail? You know, if you're speeding, I believe it is extreme. If you violate another traffic law, such
but,
as
but wait, hold on. I don't want to interrupt.
Me.
I know, but
you never let me finish my thought.
But we have to stop at that point, because you're saying if you're speeding, that's a what did you call it? Because you said it like it's a real serious thing if you're speeding.
We'll have to play it back later because I don't recall what I said.
Well, just say what you think speed, because if you're going...
I said that it wasn't an extreme...
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I thought you said it was. I thought you said speeding was an extreme thing.
Well, my mistake if I had said was.
You
I
did.
Meant
that's why
wasn't.
I stopped you. Okay. I'm sorry. Go
okay.
ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Anyway, so maybe speeding isn't an extreme, you know, law, you know, violation, whatever. But then what about when you, because for example, in my situation, what about when you drive recklessly or you run a red light or you almost hit a pedestrian or something?
Driving recklessly is an interpretation, though. That's very subjective, but go ahead.
I know, but what
if... As opposed to, like, you could say...
What if you cut someone off and...
Yeah, but that's still subjective.
Like, you don't drive safely. Like, what if you really cut it close? Like, I've been cut off to where people, you know, almost hit me.
Yeah, but that's still, whether that's reckless driving or not, that's still open to interpretation. Running a red light is either you did or you didn't, right?
Yes.
And
or
say speeding
hitting,
or going over
a pedestrian.
Well, or going over the speed limit. You either did or you didn't. But when it comes to reckless driving, that's very subjective. You could say, I think that person, what they just did was reckless driving, right? And I could say, I don't think it was reckless driving. I think what they did was wrong, that they're not following the quote-unquote rules of the road. But
well, what I think is reckless driving, whether or not you're following the rules or not, is just, you know, let's say you're let's say generally people are going of a certain speed and you're going even more faster, and there's, it's kind of hard to explain this because we're on the radio.
Just so you know, just real quick, not to interrupt, but just real quick, because I think this is a point that people need to know, is that I don't know what the speed is, but if you're going over a certain amount, they do consider that reckless driving right there and will pull your license. Like if you're going like, you know, 50 miles an hour over, that's automatic. You know, if you're going like 120 down the freeway, that's automatically, I believe, considered reckless driving, and they'll pull your license right there. Just so you know that it is a certain, I don't know what the exact is for Nevada, but there is a specific, you know, if you're going 50 miles over or something like that, they will consider it reckless driving and they will just pull your license. So I just wanted that you to be clear and everybody else listening to be clear on that as well.
What I was going to say was if you're going a certain speed and someone is going extremely faster and you don't allow the person enough time to warn you that you're going to change lanes, you're going to go in front of them, or you misjudge, you know, the right amount of distance or space between your two cars, you know, in that split moment, what if that person, you know, isn't not necessarily not paying attention, but they don't necessarily see you? Because it happens to me all the time, because I have a blind spot when I sit in my car. My, you know, side view mirror always blocks, you know, the person to my right or my left's blinker. And I can't tell that they're about to turn and they're about to go in front of me. What if in that split moment I decide to go faster and they're going to turn, you know, switch lanes in front of me? I think it should be, you know, a right amount distance ahead of you, you know, and then wait to see where their speed is, to see if they're going to go faster or if they're letting you go. Some people just go. But what if, like, in that split moment you decide, you know what, I'm going to go a little faster. And then I think that's how most accidents happen.
But who's to judge? So what you're doing is you're saying that maybe in your opinion, that's a example of, say, reckless driving. And you believe that that person should be ticketed, or maybe their license should be suspended or something like that. That's your opinion. How do you measure that? And who do you let that be up to? So you give the government essentially the power to say, well, based on what these people said, and that's what you're going to get, too. You're going to get your opinion and another person's opinion. And then you give them that ability to decide, well, this was reckless driving or this wasn't, or this warrants whatever. And you're kind of, you know, taking a subjective situation and really not, you can't have a specific law on that.
Well, here's where you and I disagree.
Well, a lot, because I don't, you know, believe that the whole system is fucked up, but go ahead.
It is, there is a lot. You know, there's a bigger picture, and I am a believer in, it's like, where do you draw the line? You know, when is enough enough? When is it okay? When is it not okay? But here's the thing. How do you get people to drive in a coordinated manner? How do you ensure that it happens for the safety of your fellow drivers? What's, you know, and you can't stand, you know, the idea of the police kidnapping you and taking you to the jail. But I'm thinking, where do you draw the line? That's why when you go to court and you plead your case to the judge, you know, and he or she will decide, you know, whether to fine you or, you know, depending, send you on Travis school, like,
which,
you know,
gives them more power,
well,
than they should have.
It's,
but
it's just like you plead your case. Well, okay, I, you know, was not that I wasn't paying attention. I just simply didn't see it, or I don't know. You plead your case, you know, you give your reason, and the ideal, you know, purpose of the judge, you know, he's supposed to be of the utmost credentials and have, you know, the best judgment. Nowadays, but not,
they're
not so much.
And they're elected.
Now,
and you
now,
know,
nowadays, they're
most
not.
Most of them
but
are elected,
it,
too.
You know, ideally, they're supposed to. Now, they just want revenue. Now, yeah. Now, in this world, it's not.
But
ideally,
most of the traffic,
it's supposed to.
Just so everybody knows, most of the judges that deal with traffic court are elected judges. So anybody who gets enough votes can become an elected judge. You know, there are appointed ones, and those are more on a higher level, a federal level. But the judges that deal with traffic court, and I know at least in Nevada, and I'm assuming in other places, they're elected. And judges that are elected are usually failed lawyers. So I know what you're saying, that, you know, ideally that's what people expect, but that's not what you get.
My point that I was trying to make was, how do you get people to follow a way of driving so everyone can be safe? It all does make sense, but you know, you do get those who don't, you know, follow the law or whatever, follow safe practices, if you call it. And you get these people of speed, and you get these people that, you know, tend to cause accidents, or, you know, and then you can't really blame someone, you know, not that they did it on purpose, but those who aren't paying attention. You know, people go to work every day, or people are going somewhere. And what if, you know, someone who's on the road is tired? You know, not that they're lazy or reckless or not paying attention, you know, because they are careless, but, you know, maybe because they're tired, and you have all these things that factor in.
But
it's like,
that's
how do
happen
you,
anyway.
I know, but it's like, how do you make the odds, you know, better to ensure traffic safety for everyone as a whole?
But you're making it worse on other levels. So you could say you could say that is the trade-off worth it? And I would say no, because people don't follow the laws anyway. And I would say that the majority of people follow traffic laws not because they're afraid of getting into trouble, that they don't want to get in an accident. Like, most people don't want to get in an accident. They follow the traffic laws not because of the police. They follow what they believe is safe. It's just like, have you ever ran a red light when no one else was around?
Actually, no. The only time I ever, and I have run a red
light. Well, most people have. If there's nobody there, like,
the only time I've ever ran a red light is when I just simply did not realize that there was a red light.
Well, most people, if it's, say, 3 a.m. and no one's on the road and they're sitting at a red light, they know it's safe. They'll make sure. And they'll go through it, because why not? The whole point is about, you know, being safe, not just following a rule to follow a rule. So, and I've done it, and I do it now. If it's safe, where there's certain areas where it's easily safe because there's not a lot of traffic, I'll check to make sure it's safe. And if it's a place where it is, then yeah, I'll go through it. If it's not, then obviously I won't. But do you want to talk about what happened with you? And first of all, do you believe that what you did warrants a citation? Because you had gotten a citation.
Well,
and before you say that, just so people know, because this might be different in your state. In Nevada, if you're in an accident and they consider you at fault, because the other person didn't get a citation, right? Only
no, I believe they do. If you're, no matter
well,
who's wrong,
not fair.
No matter who's wrong or right, you still get a citation. No, and here's the reason why. Play by play, this is what happened to me. I had my eyes on the road. I was fully paying attention to where I was driving. I had been under some stress, and I was chatting in the car with my friend. And I ran through the red light. I at no point recollect seeing the red light, acknowledging that the light was red. I was in the middle of the intersection, and this all happened in a split moment. I saw the car to my left coming, and it wasn't slowing down. In a split moment, I said to myself, oh my gosh, this car isn't slowing down. It's gonna hit me. Why? I have the right of way, right? And I look up and the light is red. And in that just, split moment, they got the tail end of me. Now,
for everybody understands, hold on. You are at an intersection, right? And
yes, I say that? I was in the intersection.
So you were at an intersection, a four-way light, and you had went through the red light, and on the other side, the person was
to my left. Didn't I just say that?
The green light, and they had hit you. I'm just making sure everybody understands the scenario and how the accident had happened, and then you were hit in the back, towards the back of your car, like the back seat.
Back left. My rear left, they hit me. And, but my insurance told me that, you know, yes, even though you admit fault, it's not entirely your fault because there were two drivers here. And I thought about it. And honestly, I think if that person was paying attention to the road, they would have saw me. They had an opportunity to swerve to avoid me. I mean, think about it. They hit the tail end of me. Had they been paying attention, they could have swerved and avoided me. It's not like they T-boned me. It's not like they didn't have enough time to stop. You know, they didn't hit me in the middle of my car. They got me at the very rear left. So honestly, I don't have proof. He'd admit to anything.
So if they were going a little slower, they probably would have just missed you.
Yeah, if they were going a little bit slower, they would have missed me. If they were going a little bit slower, I do feel that he would have been able to stop in time or even avoid me.
Right.
Because I remember, like I said, I had my eyes on the road. I didn't feel that he slowed down. Like, you think about it. You're in peripheral vision. You see someone coming at you, and it happened in a second. So
yeah,
they did not attempt.
Slows down.
Yeah, time did slow down, except him. So yes, I ran a red light. I admitted it.
Which you should never do, by the way. I know you were nervous and everything, and I'm not blaming you, but I'm just saying for people out there, never admit fault, never give them any more information than you have to. Of course, you have to give them, your name and the address, that type of information, insurance card, whatnot, but never give them any admission of guilt or at fault or any of that type of stuff. I know what happens is people tend to get nervous, and when you get nervous, things will come out, but try to stay relaxed and not give that information out.
You were right. I was nervous, and I have this thing about I couldn't lie, when they asked me, hey, what happened? And I was just honest, and I said,
well, I'm not encouraging people to lie, just to get that clear. I'm just saying that just don't answer the, questions, and don't volunteer the information. Don't lie about what happened either, because that could get you into trouble. I'm just saying, not to admit guilt or to volunteer that information.
And might I add as well, that was a very strange evening because the other driver was this 19-year-old kid. In the time that we got into the accident, I called my insurance. They took my information, my story. They took my friend's information. They took his information. I got back on the phone with them, and the tow truck was on its way. And then finally, I was talking to the other driver. He hadn't even called his own insurance. He had worked for Amazon, I believe. He had called his coworkers, which were probably also his friends, to come and pick him up and the merchandise.
So he was in the middle of working then, yeah. Right? And that was an Amazon work truck?
It was a car. It was a Nissan Sentra.
But it was.
I have no idea if it was a company vehicle. I think it was. I'm not sure. But at the same time, he was more concerned about getting out of there to transport his merchandise. And he even left. The other cop ended up calling a city tow. He even left before the city tow came to pick up his car.
Well, being 19, he probably hasn't had his license that long or a lot of life experience. So I'm sure that's probably one of the first accidents he may have gotten in before.
Even so, anyways.
No, I know. I'm just saying.
So
in that situation, you said that both of you guys got citations from the police. So I guess in Nevada, that if you get in an accident, now this is not strange, but if you get in an accident on private property, which luckily for me is any accident I've been in, and really I think it's only one or two. One was with an inanimate object. And
what does that even mean?
It means I hit a sign.
Oh my God.
So that was on private property. And, you know, I hit a parked car before, and I had a minor accident a couple months ago where we were in a parking lot and it was like a, you know, tapped each other. And I actually still didn't get they called me to tell me who they had put the fault on, which was probably me, although I don't believe it was my fault, but I never actually called them back. But it was a very minor accident. But those were all private property. So for accidents that happen on private property in the state of Nevada, and private property doesn't just mean your house. It means if you're at a store or in a parking lot somewhere or any of that is considered private property, the police won't even come now. So they used to come if you called them, but they weren't required to. But now they won't even come, which is a good thing.
Unless it's like a major injury.
I guess, yeah, if it was, I mean, if somebody's dead. But
even then, yeah, I mean, unless someone gets killed. But even if there is an injury,
there has to be something serious.
You can even just call the ambulance.
Right.
I mean, unless someone wants to press charges, can you press charges?
Well, press charges how? It's an accident. It's the same, you know, unless you're running somebody over on purpose. If you're doing that, then that's a little different. But besides that, the police don't have to be involved because it's the same thing. Your insurance companies get involved, so it doesn't really matter. But yeah, you can call an ambulance if the accident is bad enough to where somebody needs medical attention. You can call an ambulance, but as far as filing a police report, it's not needed. So you won't get a citation because obviously the police aren't going to come there. But if it's not on private property, you will get a citation if the police come. And I don't know if you're required to call them or not. I would avoid that, to be honest, if possible, if you get in an accident and it's not too serious and it's not on private property, to try to avoid calling the police because you're both going to get citations anyway. So I was saying, do you think that you deserve to get a citation, and do you support that law that just because you were in an accident that you should also get a citation? I mean, it's bad enough going through the stress of an accident. And if it's your fault, your insurance might go up. You have to deal with getting your car fixed. Why should you get a citation? And I would say because the city government or the county government wants more money. But do you think that you should have got a citation and that there should be a law that says if you get in an accident, you get a citation? Because I think it's ridiculous. Along with a lot of other laws, but I mean, we're talking about this specifically. So I think in your case, or in anybody's case for that matter, unless it's a criminal unless there's criminal negligence and you're actually going to charge somebody with a crime, because a citation is civil, even though you're in an accident, it's a civil charge where you get a ticket, really, is what it is, right?
I was going to say, since I didn't do it on purpose, I shouldn't have. Yeah. But if someone purposely does it, like, in a dangerous manner, then yeah.
Well, you can't really prove
that. But then, yeah, that's the thing, though. You would need a witness. You would need proof. But how do you do that?
It would only be if you could, if somebody ran somebody over on purpose and you could prove that. But then it would be a criminal charge. Then you have vehicular homicide or vehicular assault. Assault with a dangerous weapon, the dangerous weapon being the car. So those are all criminal charges. But yeah, if you're in any accident, it sounds like, and there may be exceptions to this, I'm not sure, but it sounds like any accident, you get a citation. And I don't know if that's for the whole state or that's a Clark County statute. It would sound like it would be for the whole state. But I know it is the law in Clark County. So you don't think that you should get a citation for an accident, right? As you,
yeah, not for that, because it's not like I did it on purpose.
Right,
it was
an accident. Because again, if you did it on purpose, you'd get a criminal charge.
Yeah.
For whether it's destruction of property, there was a video.
I was going to say, I can understand, like, when police witness, you know, someone running a red light. I could see that, even if I didn't do it on purpose. Even that is more justifiable. But if the police officers don't witness anything, then how can they say? Again, it's my fault because I admitted guilt. But
right.
I was so nervous that night. And I was, like, really scared out of my mind.
Which is understandable.
You know, so.
But there's a video when I was kind of researching via YouTube different things where this guy's pissed at the cop, I guess. The cop just pulled him over. So the cop is walking towards his car. And the cop wasn't hurt or anything. And I posted this on my Facebook page, the End the Government Police Facebook page. And I also believe the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Facebook page, where he backs up right over, he floors it, and he actually goes up onto the hood of the police car. With the back of his car. It's kind of funny. And you know what? I feel like they deserve it. I mean, he didn't hit the cop or anything, so that was fine. But he did damage the car and smash the windshield. But, I mean, that's where they stopped the video, and I'm sure he got arrested right after and charged with destruction of property. So that would be a criminal offense there where he purposely tried to damage his property. So with your story, what happened was that they said that you had to take care of it within
90 days,
and that you had a court date. So you could have either went to court on that date or paid the ticket prior to that date. And
yes.
I believe the ticket was what, like $250-something?
Something, and I got slapped with all kinds of fees.
We'll talk about that in a minute,
but the
original ticket, I believe, was like $258, I think.
I believe so.
So when you didn't show up for court, and this wasn't something that, you know, you did on purpose, you confused the date of the occurrence and thought the 90 days was this week, actually.
I was thinking it was, for some reason, February 12th was in my mind. According to the date on the website, it was January 19th. And I completely missed my window. I don't know why. I kept thinking February. I have no idea why.
So what happened was on the day ended up 90 days ended up being something like April 15th was the court date. And what they did was they automatically added a $100 fee for something. And then they and not to mention that $258, the citation for the red light and the accident, is made up of a bunch of different things as well. It's not just for the actual citation. It's like made up of different fees. It's ridiculous. $258. It's insane. But on top of that, there was a $100 fee added, and then there was a $150 warrant fee added. So essentially for the past like 3 weeks, you were driving around with a warrant out for your arrest, where if you were stopped, you would have been arrested for an outstanding warrant. And the other thing is it was sent to collections, to a collection agency. So you had paid it yesterday and you had to call the collection agency and pay it. And then they, I guess, notify the court. And that's how it gets taken care of.
They didn't even tell me the details. I had called. I told them that I had a ticket that's, you know, I don't even remember. She's looked it up and she told me that it has gone to warrant. And I said, I'm aware. And I'm going to pay it in full. And then after everything was paid, I asked her, you know, I was requesting an emailed receipt of some kind. She point blank told me that she could not provide me with a receipt.
See that? I don't
understand. And I was like, why can't I have a receipt even for my record? And she point blank said, I cannot provide you with a receipt. And then she proceeded to say, you may request a written letter that you have paid the balance after the payment has posted, which can take up to 72 hours. And I was just like in awe. Like, are you? So then I told her.
I would get that letter. So if I
get pulled over, she didn't even let me finish my sentence. She's like, yes, you will get arrested. I'm like, oh my God. I stood quiet. And then after that, I don't remember what I said. And the last thing she told me was that, good luck to you, ma'am. Like, kind of like sad for me.
Yeah. I'm sure they use like a certain government contractor collection agency, or maybe they even work for the government, but either way it's taxpayer money that goes to them, so they can act, you know, like assholes. But it's ridiculous. And the other thing is, you had renewed your license during this time and they didn't say anything to you neither.
They didn't. I because remember usually they'll you were tell the one you. Who thought about that, and I don't know. I have no idea.
Because usually it will be in their records, because I had a friend before tell me that the DMV had told him he had a warrant out for something else that had nothing to do with traffic, but he had a warrant out and they still renewed his license and they didn't call the police or anything, but it came up in their records. So the fact that they didn't say anything about it, and this is related directly to traffic, is surprising. So, but again, I mean, to me, that would be essentially kidnapping you over not paying a ticket that you could be sitting in jail. And I don't know if it works any differently than when you're arrested on a regular warrant. And I doubt it is, because when I was arrested and just waiting for them to process my bail, there was somebody that was there who had a jaywalking warrant that they didn't pay their jaywalking ticket. And I would put that equally with not paying because I believe that's a civil infraction as well. Not paying a motor vehicle ticket. And they were in jail 5 days because it was over Memorial Day weekend. They had lost their job. And, well, they said pretty much, I'm going to lose my job because I've been here, you know, this amount of days. I'm not going to see the judge until this day, and that will be 5 days. And it's really ridiculous, the whole system. But we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll get more into the whole system of traffic laws and the policing of them, and how it is a lot more worse than you think. People think that usually it's not a big deal. Oh, it's just a ticket. It's not a big deal. But it is a big deal. And when it comes to pulling people over, it is a big deal. So we'll talk all about that, our opinions on maybe ways to improve the system or get rid of it altogether, or how we feel about the current system of travel in general, more motor vehicle travel. So we will be back after this. If you'd like to call in, again, the number 702-470-7664, 702-470-7664, and you can Skype into the show at Nonpartisan Liberty for All is the username. Just send a contact request, your name and what you want to talk about. And all that information is also at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. That's NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Be sure to check us out there. There's also a donate button. So if you'd like to donate to the show, we would really appreciate it. Of course, everything is done for free. Well, meaning that we're supported by my salary from my other job. So I don't expect anybody to donate, but if you'd like to donate, we'd really appreciate it. Or just supporting the show, like us on Facebook, tell your friends about us and share the events and the show with your friends, or even just bringing up some of the topics and talking about it. I think the most important thing is really getting the word out to people and getting it hearts and minds is the main thing. So we will be right back after this. We are here with co-host Katy Reyes, a fugitive. Hey. Not really. She's paid her fine. So So we will be back after this Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Officer Ricky Antoine is known around Port Arthur, Texas, as the man who gave his own mother a traffic ticket. She was driving 42 miles an hour in a 30 zone out by the high school football stadium. She didn't cook him chicken dinner for the next couple months. Antoine wears sport sunglasses and drives a fuel black Dodge Charger. Cameras peer out from the top of the trunk, their lenses scanning license plates in search of drivers who haven't paid their traffic fines. License plate recognition software is often touted as a way to catch terrorists, dangerous fugitives on the run, and stolen cars. But Port Arthur and many other departments around the country use it for a less extreme but more lucrative purpose. To pull over people who owe debts to the city municipal court, demanding, in many cases, that they either pay up or go to jail. The brochure that reached Police Chief Blanton's desk in 2008 displayed a picture of Manhattan's Chrysler Building, lit up against the night sky. The software the brochure advertised was called the Mobile Plate Hunter 900 Series, and it could read up to 1,500 license plate images per minute across four lanes of traffic, and alert officers within milliseconds if a vehicle is suspect. The technology could aid law enforcement not just with Homeland Security, but also with stolen cars, Amber Alerts, and wanted or missing persons. The pitch gave Blanton another idea. Why not give the device to his traffic unit to catch people who had arrest warrants for their unpaid tickets? Typically, the people who didn't pay the city the money they owed would only be held to account if officers caught them on a different driving infraction. The police plate readers would allow the officer to pull people over without any other probable cause. The number of Port Arthur debtors in the county jail had already started to surge, but with the advent of the license plate readers, it exploded. The amount the city spent on locking people up jumped 175%, but at the same time, revenue from fines rose by more, from $1.2 million to $2.1 million. In Port Arthur, the impact is especially stark. The city of 55,000 is one of the poorest in Texas. For many residents already struggling to meet their obligations, traffic tickets add yet another burden that may tip them into further financial ruin. Many end up behind bars. For low-income hourly workers, time in jail can cost them a job, and even if they don't lose their job, they lose wages. Missing a few days of work can make the difference between staying afloat and drowning in debt. Traffic safety is equally important for poor people and for people with money, but traffic fines, as they're typically imposed, inflict far more pain on poor people. A recent BuzzFeed News investigation found that some judges across Texas routinely ignore basic state and federal laws meant to protect people from getting jailed simply because they're too poor to pay their fines. And that's not the case in Port Arthur. Municipal Judge Kermit Morrison tries to help people struggling with their fines, offering them community service or payment plans that can run as low as $5 per month. Port Arthur's attempt to work with people is helpful, said Judith Green, director of the New York-based nonprofit policy research group Justice Strategies. But even community service places a hardship on people who may have low-income jobs that consume much of their time and may have children to look after. And it's a hardship that the wealthy, who simply pay their fines, don't have to face. As a result, she said, poor people go to jail and rich people walk. Port Arthur's traffic enforcement frenzy has begun to level off. Fine collection had risen to 3 times higher than it was before the traffic unit, but nowadays it's back down to merely double. Jailing has dropped in the past 18 months too. That may be because 3 of the 6 license plate reader cars stopped working within the past 2 years, and the city has been slow to replace them. Another factor is that Antoine is more of a figurehead these days. He teaches driver safety classes, writes a column in the Port Arthur News called Ask a Cop, and co-hosts a weekly radio show. All this leaves less time for traffic stops. Despite his zeal for writing tickets, Antoine said he takes no joy from hauling people in poverty to lockup. You have a heart, and you feel for those people, he said. The judge could charge $1. I don't care.
Okay, in this video, what we're trying to do is help those that know that they have warrants in Dallas County find those warrants and figure out exactly what to do with them in order to get the warrants lifted and to keep the violations from going on their permanent record. Now, we get calls all day, every day from residents of Dallas County and the surrounding areas saying, hey, I got a ticket. I lost it. I know it's in warrant. I know it was in Dallas County. Okay, but the problem with that is that Dallas County is such a huge, huge county with so many cities and JP precincts that it can sometimes be like finding a needle in a haystack. And there's no silver bullet to make sure that you've got them all. What you're hoping is that the city or the county that has issued the warrant has posted it on one of the public websites that we use to search for them. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to take you to one of those websites to kind of show you what we do when we get that kind of client that calls in and is not real sure where the ticket's at, but just knows for certain that it's in Dallas County. So what we want to do is we want to go to Google. And after going to Google, we're going to type in Dallas County Most Wanted. And this is it's a public website ran by Dallas County. And this is what it looks like. You've got all these different sections you can click on. You've got this section down here called Traffic Tickets. You've also got this one called Dallas County Wanted. Now, a lot of people will click on this link, the traffic tickets link, and you don't want to do that. The reason why is because this is an option to actually just pay off your tickets. And I've talked about this in other videos, but paying off your traffic tickets is the equivalent of being found guilty at trial on that offense. If you're found guilty, then it has to be reported to the Department of Public Safety as a conviction on your permanent record, which means it will never be erased, and it can be counted against you for usually a three-year period, sometimes longer depending on the offense. Say, for example, you get a no insurance ticket and you pay that off. Your license will automatically be suspended until you pay $780 over 3 years and submit proof of SR-22 insurance to the Department of Public Safety. So it's not a wise decision to pay the tickets off just to get them out of warrant. What you need to do is find them and get the warrants lifted, usually through an attorney that can help you keep those off your permanent record and keep your driver's license clear. So what you want to do when you go to this site is you want to click on the Dallas County Wanted tab right there. Okay. Now this is where you want to be. If you see this screen, you're in the right spot. What you want to do is you want to come down here and you click on continue, and then you're able to type in your identifying information. Now they don't require a whole lot. So if you typed in, say, John Smith, it'll bring up pretty much every John Smith that has warrants reported to this public website. And so what you want to do is you want to find the John Smith that you are at the address that you lived at when you got the violation, and you want to look for your date of birth. This will tell you whether or not it's in warrant. It'll also tell you if you have a scofflaw hold holding up your ability to get your registration renewed. There'll also be photos sometimes of people that have been arrested in the past. So this person right here, let's just click on John I. Smith. You look at his case. You can see that he's got 1, 2, 3 that have been reported to this website. And you can see the date of the offense. He got these tickets on August the 7th of 2010 for running a stop sign. He then failed to appear on one of these. I guess he pretty much got them back to back on these. And then he got another ran stop sign. So is there a hold on his registration? Yes. And are they in warrant? Can he be picked up and taken to jail on them? Yes.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And we are back here with our co-host for this evening, who usually joins us on Thursday, but she's joining us tonight this week, Katy Reyes. Tomorrow, our bi-weekly co-host, I guess it would be bi-weekly, he joins us every other Wednesday. Ken Shorgen will be joining us to talk about geopolitics and the economy. I'm sure there is a lot of stuff that he has to bring up since the last time he was on a couple weeks ago. So be sure to tune in to that. We are on Tuesday through Thursday, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. So tonight we're talking all about traffic tickets, and not just traffic tickets, which is what we really focused on in the first part of the show, but traffic laws and how the whole travel system, motor vehicle travel system in general, works, which I think is totally unfair. So I remember when I was like 19, I was writing out this thing. I was kind of inspired by the movie Panther. I don't know if anybody's seen that. It's a kind of a biopic on the Black Panthers. I had read about them way before that in high school. Surprisingly enough, my high school had the autobiography of Huey Newton or the autobiography of Bobby Seale, who was the second kind of Bobby Seale and Huey Newton started the Black Panthers together. But Bobby Seale was more the number two guy. But I guess they were kind of almost equals anyway. So I read the autobiography of Bobby Seale, and then I read a book on Huey Newton that I believe somebody else had written. And it was surprising that the library, our school library, actually had books on the Black Panthers. So that was cool, as well as Malcolm X, who I had read about as well. But I remember writing out this thing of what things I didn't believe that the government could do, because even back then, not to the extent I am now, but I always felt like the government was oppressive and took too many rights and freedoms away from people, especially when it came to the police. And I unfortunately had a lot of experiences with the police when I was younger. So one of the things I remember writing down is probably the only thing I remember. Well, I remember them not one of the things being that they can't come in your house, whether they have a warrant or not, but being able to pull you over. I thought that, and I still think, the police being able to pull you over is not a right that the government should have, period. And most of it, I believe, has to do with the drug war, to be honest. Because when you think about it, I mean, they're a lot of times they're looking, I'm not saying 100% of it, but a lot of times they're looking for things or trying to check if you have drugs or plant them or whatever. So I definitely don't believe that the police have a right to pull you over. However, if you do not pull over for a cop, you're most likely, and I remember reading a story a couple months ago in Houston where a man was killed by the police and he was unarmed, but he didn't pull over. And when he did, I think he got out the car. And of course, they said, well, his hand was in whatever spot and they shot him and killed him. And of course, again, he was unarmed. But if you do not pull over for the police, most likely you will end up dead. Or if not, you will get dragged out of your car and beaten and end up in jail. And that's just for not pulling over for the police. So even something like that, where they have this authority to pull you over anytime they want if you're in a car. Now, I don't really honestly respect that authority. It's just out of fear, because everything is based on violence and force in the barrel of a gun. So obviously, if they didn't have the ability to call in, you know, hundreds of men and guns and helicopters and all these things, then why pull over? Fuck them. But most people, you're not going to be able to get out of that situation. Although I did hear a couple stories from somebody who was driving a car that was unregistered, and they were like, they would speed all the time and always get their license suspended. And they actually got away from the police. And, you know, they were lucky. These days, I don't know that you would, because I think they would call helicopters in. Katy, I don't know what your opinion on that is.
I always fantasize about the idea of being able to outrun the police, but you're right now with helicopters and stuff.
Not in your car.
Yeah, I know.
But sorry, you were saying with helicopters and...
I mean, I totally, you know, can see them calling, a helicopter and tracking your vehicle. And, you know, even if you were to be able to run on foot, you wouldn't be able to outrun them on foot.
The place you'd want to go is an airport, because and I know this from a movie, because of flight patterns. Helicopters can't just randomly fly over airports like that. So I do know that.
Just you hear that, everyone? If you want to run away from the police, you know, in a car chase, a speed chase, go to the airport.
Well, I'm not saying you should do that. You should always preface it where you're not, what do you call it?
Suggesting.
that people do that. You're just saying that
helicopters
interfere with flight patterns. But I mean, we have helicopters that I don't know if you hear them, but I've seen them. They fly over the neighborhood all the time.
I rarely pay attention. You're the one who's always freaking out about stuff like that.
Well, I mean, because I believe they're police helicopters. But what about if police weren't able to pull people over? Would it even make that much of a difference? Because you look at the reasons why they're able to pull people over right now. And, you know, another reason I think would be drinking and driving if they're swerving or something like that. But right now, they can pretty much pull you over for anything, even though the law states that, well, you have to meet this whatever. I mean, they can say make up anything, really, and pull you over for it. I mean, they, when I was, 17, and I was with my friend, and we were in a town that was, I would say, racist, and I was with my friend and his brother, who are black, and they tried to say that we were on the freeway, and he touched the dotted line for a second and then went back. That's what they said. They wrote him a $129 ticket and they pulled me out of the car and searched me because I was trying to put my seatbelt on, and I had a pocket knife that in Massachusetts everything's illegal, so they might have considered that illegal. So I kind of handed it to my friend's brother and he, you know, hit it. But I was really just trying to get my seatbelt on, and they pulled me out of the car and searched me and whatnot. But the point being is that they can use any reason to pull you over if they want to.
Yeah, I guess what I feel, that they should only pull people over in extreme cases, you know, like if someone is driving recklessly, you know, swerving, cutting off cars, you know, potentially about to cause an accident. Because people can, you know, speed, or what is, you know, considered speeding, and still drive safe. I read an article that people who drive faster then the speed limit tend to be the safest drivers because they're driving faster than the speed limit, they are more alert. The people that cause the most accidents are those that drive slow, that drive basically under the speed limit, or drive way above the speed limit, meaning driving above what everyone else is driving, like a good, you know, 15, 20 miles.
I usually drive right around speed limit or 5 miles over just because I don't want to get pulled over and deal with police. That's the only reason. If it wasn't for that, I'd probably go. It depends where I'm at. I'd go what it's safe to go. And that might be what the speed limit is. It might be a little faster. If it's raining, I'm going to go way below the speed limit because our roads in Las Vegas aren't made for rain because it never rains. So they get pretty slick. So
Can I say something?
Sure.
They get slick because it doesn't rain often to wash the oil away. It has nothing to do with the roads.
Is that what it is? I thought how they made them.
No, it has nothing. All the roads are the same. It's just that wherever it rains often, you know, because the water rinses the oil
that gets
constantly
the roads from the cars.
Yeah. And here, because it doesn't rain as often, there's more oil on the street. So when it does rain, that's why the roads are slick.
So there you go. So yeah, because of that, I'm very careful when it's raining, especially with my car, which is kind of light. But I mean, what happens is, though, like you said, in, say, your scenario, you think that the police should only be able to pull people over under, you know, certain circumstances. But how do you stop them from doing that? And that's the whole point, right, is that once you give people this power, they're gonna abuse it. And that's exactly what the police do and the government does and all these other agencies with power over people, is that they abuse that power, and the police especially. And I mean, they're doing a whole bunch of things now that they shouldn't be doing. They're not supposed to have quotas. We know they do. I mean, a lot of it is about the money, because they actually budget. And I've seen, you know, you can look at the budget for Clark County. They budget based on, you know, they budget that ticket revenue that they're going to get. They budget warrant revenue. They even budget bail defaults. So they factor into the budget things that they shouldn't be getting, period, in my opinion. So they'll put in the budget that they're going to get however amount of money from tickets that are paid, or from people that don't show up for bail, that don't show up for court and they get to keep their bail, or things like that. The other thing that they have now that was in one of the clips I played is they have these license plate readers, and you can see them on the cars. They're like these little, I can't really explain how they look, but they're like kind of sticking out on the police car. And they, in some places, I don't know what they're doing here, but they use those to find people that have warrants. So they'll use the license plate readers not only to track wherever you go, but also to find people that have warrants. So everywhere that car goes, they're picking those up. And they can, I mean, the amount of license plates that they can pick up, it's like a ridiculous speed. I remember they had said in the clip, I don't remember exactly how many it was, but the speed that they can pick these up at is crazy, the amount that the license plate readers can pick up. But that's another thing that they use that obviously they shouldn't be using. And if you look at the DMV in general, they have created this whole agency, essentially, that is used in ways that were not the purpose of what it was created for. So, for example, your license plates are not supposed to be so the police can track wherever you go. And I don't think license plates should exist, period. And the your license is not supposed to be so they can have a picture of you that they can put, an electronic picture that they can put inside a database, so they have a picture of you for Homeland Security. If they, I mean, really, so many people post their picture everywhere, and including me. But I, to be honest, I've been doing it more for show purposes and to share pictures with family than anything else. But if I got off the show, I would, even though it wouldn't matter because they keep the data when you leave anyway, is I would get off of Facebook and all social media, and I would delete everything. But it doesn't matter because they hold all that information. But for people that aren't on social media, the federal government has a picture, your license picture, because now it's all automated and digital. So they load that in. So these are things that the DMV says, oh, well, you need a license because of this, but then they use it for something else. Or you need a license plate because of this reason, and then they use it for something else and have the license plate readers and all of that. And there are, and I have a clip, actually, of, I'll have to find that clip, of the police going to somebody's house, arresting them, and I definitely want to play this. I won't play it yet, but arresting them or arresting him for a warrant that he had for not paying a ticket. Now, a lot of people will blame, so like in your situation, they'll say, well, that's your fault because you should have paid your ticket. But who says that you should have to pay a ticket? Where do people, sorry about that, where do people actually consent? First of all, nobody consents to any of these laws anyway. So let's just, you know, make that clear as it is, that nobody consents to any of these laws. But.
And how many people would consent to them? Because a lot of people, they, you know, they talk the talk. They say, oh, what about the roads and all this stuff? But really, if you were to really give people a choice, how many people would consent to these laws and willingly pay?
I don't know. I don't think as many people as we probably think. But unfortunately, there is a certain amount of people who, you know, like you have, especially mothers, something with mothers, man. It's kids ruin everything. Because like Mothers Against Drunk Driving, Mothers Against This, they form these organizations. But you have a certain amount of people that say, oh, we need this. It's for, at least those are the people that get the publicity because they want you to think that everybody thinks that way. But, you know, I don't, it's hard to really gauge how many people would actually pay if, and obviously not enough, because otherwise, why wouldn't it be voluntary to pay taxes?
What if they, because this is what I was thinking, because it is totally and completely about the money. It's not about, I mean, it is, but it isn't. But it's more about the money than public safety. Because really, there's a lot of other ways that the government could enforce, you know, safe driving and for people to abide by the law. Because they could, they don't have to arrest people. They could make it mandatory. For example, let's say you do have like X amount of, you know, traffic violations. And let's say, you know, okay, you'll get your license revoked. And then with the way technology is now, they could put it in a data system. Well, you know, you wouldn't be able to do something like buy a car. And if someone were to sell you a car, then they would get penalized somehow. There are so many other ways that they could enforce it without jail, like, or even your credit. You know, if you don't pay your tickets, you know, not put you in jail, but, you know, it could go against your credit. Because I think really people value their credit more than, you know, you think.
Yeah, but that's really, and they do that with your credit. Like with yours that got sent to the credit agency, yeah. That will go on your, it won't now because you paid it, but it would have went on your credit.
But that's what I'm saying, you know. There's so many other things that they could, like, they don't have to put people in
jail.
Yeah,
but a lot of, and I agree with you, but a lot of stuff, somebody is being forced. So what I mean is, if you say, like, didn't you say something like not being able to buy a car or not being able to...
Yeah.
So...
Getting your license revoked.
Well, okay, so, like, take that for example. So what happens if then you drive on your license? Then what do they do?
You could, you know, if you got pulled over again, the fine would increase.
And then you still don't pay your fine. So what I mean is you could keep just not but doing.
It would just go against your credit and it would make you impossible. Make it impossible for you to be able to do other things.
The only
it's a moral thing. It's, you know, not having to put people in jail, doing it in other ways.
Right. And I mean, I agree they shouldn't force anybody to do anything. And that's the whole, my whole issue is that everything's backed by force and everything leads to jail.
So, okay, what do you think? Let's say someone gets in an accident and they harm someone.
Well,
so what at that point? That's what I was saying, you know, earlier. Where do you draw the line?
Well, if they harm somebody, and it depends on the circumstances. In an accident, you know, the insurance company pays out the...
You know, they could, of course, I'm sure they would go through a trial. You know, they go, okay, were you reckless driving? You know, was it in fact an accident? You know, I'm sure they would have witnesses just like they do now.
Well, they would get... So what would happen now, assuming that it wasn't ruled, you know, it was ruled as an accident, is the insurance companies would pay for the, you know, all the injuries. And if it was something serious, you know, they'd get a settlement from the insurance company.
Yeah, and that would probably be way better than...
But the person wouldn't go, right. The person wouldn't, but now the person wouldn't go to jail. You wouldn't go to jail for that. But what I'm saying is that everything, they don't do things like that. Everything they do, they back by force because
it's like money is the root of all evil. Like they back it by force, you know, they threaten you. You know, with something that's so extreme in order to keep people in line.
Right. And it's not just traffic laws. I mean, it's everything. Now, what you said would make sense with traffic tickets where it just went to your credit report. And that would be an incentive to pay traffic tickets if it went to your credit report and it stayed there until you paid it instead of having a warrant. But there's not many things like that, other things that you could do when it comes to all of this other stuff. So, for example, like not paying taxes. And the whole thing is, like you just said, I mean, they want their money bad enough that that's not enough for them. They're not going to say, well, if you don't pay your taxes, we'll just put it on your credit report. And we'll, you know, like, what about taxes? What would they do?
That's another thing that's very interesting, because how many people supposedly commit like tax evasion or tax fraud? My father supposedly committed some kind of tax fraud, and he never went to jail. What they did was they sued him. The state sued him. They were garnishing his wages. My dad's been past 10 years now. So you can imagine back then, you know, he made between $1,000 to $1,500 a check, and because he was, you know, he was in construction. But yeah, so the federal government garnished his wages.
That's still force, though. Because
exactly.
It's force against the company that they're taking the wages from.
But that's what I'm saying. They didn't arrest him. You know, who knows? My dad, maybe he would have preferred, or I don't know. I don't think he would have. But at least to have gone to court to at least plead his case and maybe come up with some kind of payment plan. No, yeah. They didn't even do that. They just like straight up.
Or maybe he would have said, I'll go to jail for 2 weeks, clear my debt. I don't, you know.
He would have lost his job, so I think. No.
Or community service or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm just throwing things out there. But what I'm saying is, it's even in that situation, it's still forced. Because if the company you work for, and say it's a private company, and what if it's your own company? What if you own your own company and they want to garnish your wages and you say, fuck you, no. Then what are they going to do? So what I'm saying is people don't understand that you can keep going back and back. And eventually you're going to get to a point where they're going to have to use force unless they just say, fuck it. And they don't do anything to back it up. But they always do. Yeah. Now, in the case of the tickets, they could do the credit card, the credit agency thing, and they do that anyway, and that would make sense. But they also put out a warrant for your arrest. So I want to play this clip real quick, and then when we come back, we'll continue this conversation because I just want to make sure that this gets played before we end the show, because this is, to me, really disturbing. This guy's just sitting home with his wife and his kids, and he was going to pay it in a couple days, and the cops come to his house. So, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
Hello, can I help you? Good. Yes, I am. My name's Andrew.
This is where you say nothing and don't answer the door, okay? If cops are at your door, do not answer your door, especially if you know that you haven't paid a ticket, because they can't come in your house. I knew a friend that the police were looking for him. I believe they issued a warrant, and they waited outside, like down the street, for like a week, but he just didn't leave his house. And they came to the door, and he just didn't open the door. So you can do that.
My wife's breastfeeding in here, so I'm...
Okay, can you step out for me, Andrew?
May I ask what this is regarding?
You have a warrant for your arrest.
Okay. So you're coming to my house?
Yes.
And...
Everything. Did you recently get a traffic ticket or something?
Yeah, it's I haven't had the money to pay it.
Okay, they issued a warrant for you.
Okay, I did. Okay. I did get it in the mail. My plan was to pay it on Tuesday because it said to go down to the courthouse.
Okay.
I think it's $220. It was a speeding ticket.
Is that a Gahanna?
It was a Gahanna speeding ticket. Yes.
Okay. Hold on for me 1 second. Okay. You said you were just trying to get around to it.
We just had a baby, and I have not had much money. We're pretty broke, and I just...
And you think about this, right? Cops are wasting their time going to people's houses to arrest them on warrants for traffic tickets. And they did this, like I had mentioned, the guy who was in jail when I was there waiting to get bailed out, or actually had already paid my bail and just waiting to get processed. And they went to his house to arrest him on a warrant for jaywalking that they couldn't just wait, and they happened to run into him. I mean, this is what where tax money's going, is going for police to get a list and go after people for warrants for ridiculous things that probably shouldn't even be crimes in the first place.
If you think about it, like everything that they charge you for, bill you for, tax you for, it's endless. You know, where does it end?
It doesn't. It's always, they're always going to need money for something. It's a bottomless hole. It's a hole that just, it's like space. It just goes on forever. They will always need more money. No matter what it is. Now they need money for this, now that. It will never end. So I'm going to go back to the clip.
301-80-3356. 301-80-3356.
Have you been in contact with the court or the police department at all?
I haven't, no. So, sorry about the door thing. My wife,
no,
like I said, she's
understand.
Sitting right in there breastfeeding. So.
Yeah, go ahead. Did you know that they suspended your license also?
I did not.
Okay.
I mean, I got something in the mail from them today.
Okay. We have them here if you want to check and see if
yes.
they want them.
Well, I don't know if it came today, but I got it in the mail today.
Okay. You just got something in the mail. You said...
Yeah, it
what,
said...
What it
I didn't open it. It said risk of suspending license or something like that.
Okay. Yeah, it looks like they've also suspended your license.
Okay.
So, I mean, you just kind of, you can't let it go. You know what I mean? I mean, you got to...
Okay, I have the money in my bank account. I can
pay
it. I was going to pay it on Tuesday. My wife already yelled at me for not taking care of it yet.
Okay.
And I want to say with this, too, and as this goes on, it gets worse. Because really, the police supposedly are supposed to be there to serve and protect. Taxes pay their salaries. They should be helpful with this. I mean, if they came to the house... And he has the money, they should be able to just take the fucking money and process it, especially now with the technology, either take the actual money and, you know, give him a receipt for it and pay it to the court, or somehow process it through a phone or something like that. But they're basically like, we don't give a fuck about that shit. There's a part that comes up where, you know, about an ATM, and one of the officers says, well, somebody can, you know, go to the ATM for you. We're not going to take you to the ATM. It's like something like that. Like, if an officer arrested you for this and it's a traffic ticket and you had no money, and the only way for you to get money, say you didn't have a debit card, you only had an ATM card. The only way for you to get money was to stop at an ATM, or you were going to have to sit in jail. And the officer couldn't, on the way to bring you to the jail or the police station, couldn't stop at an ATM for you. Shouldn't officers be doing stuff like that? Because I think they should. If they're going to, well, I don't think they should exist at all, but these are the type of things where they're just like, no, whatever, we don't give a fuck. Too bad for you. Doesn't that defeat the, you know, what their purpose is? I mean, of course, I know what their real purpose is, and that's to, you know, keep people in line and beat them down and teach them discipline and what's going to happen if they don't obey, and make sure that they do. And anyone who's ever been in jail, even if you've just been there waiting, like I said, I was in jail a couple of days just waiting for them to process my bail. And the way they treat you is just, you know, in a minimum security jail on a little misdemeanor, waiting for them to process your fucking bail, which they take, you know, they could do in 2 seconds, but they want to fuck with you and they want you to have a really bad experience. So they do all that shit on purpose.
What we can find out is figure out how Gehenna works, whether or not they take a bond.
Yeah.
Off of that. And then,
yeah, there might be a bond amount, okay, which you'd have to pay with Gehenna.
Okay, or maybe the citation itself, but you'd have to do that down there. We're not allowed to take.
Okay. Yeah, so we'll get the bond amount here once we figure out what they want to do. Okay, then if you've already got the money or whatever.
I do have the money, and like I said, I mean, it was an expensive ticket, and I, you know, it's, I think it's been 2 or 3 months.
Yeah, it looks like probably went back in July, maybe.
Uh-huh.
Somewhere in there. Okay, well, we'll check with them, see exactly what the bond amount is, and then you can make a decision from there on what you want to do. Okay.
Okay.
And then we'll kind of go from there.
What does that mean?
Well, you can either bond out or you'll end up going to jail.
Like right now?
Yes. But they, like I said, they've issued a warrant. So
this is like for a speeding ticket. I feel like this is a little irregular. You're coming to my house and like over a speeding ticket. I mean,
you have.
We're not here over a speeding ticket. We're here for a warrant for your arrest from a judge.
Yeah. This is. I mean, it's a shakedown. It's a shakedown. It's really crappy. So, I mean, I guess find out what I need to do so I don't get ripped away from my wife and baby, which is why I didn't have enough money to pay in the first place.
Okay.
So, I mean...
It may be as simple as showing up down there, having somebody come down...
Pay like right now?
Yeah, something's
as soon as they confirm the warrant, you're going with us.
Well,
we'll meet up with Gehenna. And then somebody will go down there, pay either the bond or the speeding ticket.
So you're arresting me right now?
Well, right now, no.
No.
I mean, it's a speeding ticket. I can just pay it on Tuesday. I mean,
you kind of waited too long at that point. You just can't let things like that go.
It doesn't make it right. Just figure out what we need to do so I can get back to my family. All right?
What was your original court date?
I don't remember. Probably the week after the ticket.
It's usually within 5 to 10 days.
Yeah, it's like the week after.
Keep in mind, too, something you can always do, and it just depends on the court, but you can always ask if it's a money issue. Try to ask for an extension or something. The last thing you want to do. Yeah, the last thing you want to do
is... That's why I asked if you've been in contact with the people.
Yeah, I haven't.
Yeah, the last thing you want
to
do is kind
of... I didn't know they arrested people over speeding tickets. That's what it's come to, so... Can we just figure out what we need to do so I can...
They're calling Gehenna right now, okay?
All right. Yeah, you gotta go too fast in a 25 and you're going to show up at my house and with my family here. Arrest me.
Well, this is where you live.
Yeah, it's true. It doesn't make it right. I mean, it doesn't make what's happening here right.
Are we supposed to go to your friend's house and arrest you?
I would prefer not to be arrested over a speeding ticket. I can take care of it.
But you're not being arrested over a speeding ticket. You're being...
See, this is where it's bullshit. The guy keeps bringing up, well, you're not being arrested over a speeding ticket. You're being arrested over a warrant. Yeah. And this is how they kind of get away with, like, oh, well, a traffic ticket's only a civil infraction. You know, it's not a big deal. No, it is. Because he is being arrested over a speeding ticket because they issued a warrant because of a speeding ticket. So what is the fucking difference?
I mean, court or pay that for speeding ticket. There's a totally different charge off of that.
Just the sum of it boils down to I didn't have the money. I guess I should have talked to them, but
yeah. If you were to make contact and say, hey, I just had a baby and it's a little tight, they probably would have made it.
Yeah.
Let's court to do it.
Well, it's not going to matter now. You're going to take me somewhere.
Nope.
No?
It's not a guarantee. We have to hear what they say.
Well, there is a warrant. I mean, it said on the.
$269?
Yeah. How do I pay that?
With Gehenna.
How do I do that?
We'll go meet with Gehenna.
One of their officers will be able to explain exactly what you need to do.
Okay, well, like, can I just write a check?
We'll have to see if the check's one of their forms of payment. We don't know. We have to check with them. Sir, can you confirm your birth date also?
6/13/82. So I'm being detained, are you taking me with you? I don't understand what's happening.
Right now you can't leave.
No, I understand that, but I mean, what's happening? Are you taking me somewhere?
Well, I'm trying to figure out if you can pay the bond or not.
I can.
Okay.
I'm willing to take care of it right now. I just don't know.
Okay, here's what's gonna happen. We're gonna go meet Gehenna. Okay? And then you have to pay Gehenna.
Like I'm coming with you.
Yes.
And I have to get in your car to do that.
Yes.
And then what happens after that?
Well, you're going to go to Gehenna, and then you can either pay Gehenna to their court systems.
Okay.
Okay, at that point in time, you bond out, and they'll explain everything to you.
What does bond out mean? Is that $260? Is that what
$269,
$269,
yeah.
Cash or surety?
How am I supposed to get cash?
I didn't catch what she said.
Cash or surety, $269.
So it's got to be cash?
Or surety, which is the bond.
I mean, can I go to an ATM? I mean...
You can have somebody else go to an ATM. We can't take you to an ATM.
But are you arresting me right now? Is that what's happening? I don't understand what the situation is.
Yes, so you're going to be placed under arrest for the warrant. Yes. They want you.
This is extortion. I need to tell my wife what's going on.
Okay, I just can't let you go inside the house.
She said cash or card.
Cash or card.
I have a card on me.
You have a card on you?
I have a card on me.
That they can swipe and credit and it's put in there. That's all we need.
Okay, sounds good. Come on back to my car here real quick, okay?
My wife's in there with my baby. Can I let her know what's going on?
Yeah, well, you want to yell for it real quick? We'll kind of explain everything that's going on.
Okay. And what happens after we get to Gehenna?
Well, what happens?
Is someone going to give me a ride back or what's happening? Someone has to come pick me up?
Yeah, they're going to have to come pick you up.
I could go do this willingly. I don't have to do this.
I'm here right now. come in.
So I need someone to pick me up in the attic. Well, however long it takes. Can I call her when I get there?
Yeah, we take your phone and everything with you.
I'm not allowed to come back in, so. Can you just have everyone hang out? Maybe Gatsby can pick me up? I don't know what to do. They're men with guns are taking me away, so let's go.
Okay. Go ahead and turn on H4 for me right here.
So you're actually going to do this.
Promoting the ideas of true freedom and liberty, Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. And that was just ridiculous to me. And he even actually gets it because he sits there and he's like, it's extortion. And it is extortion, and that he had said at the end, too, well, men with guns are coming to take me away. So what if you said, look, you know what? Fuck you. You have no right. You're kidnapping me, because that's what they're doing. They're kidnapping him. It's extortion. They're saying that it's like the mafia. They're saying, you owe us this money because we say you do, essentially, because you have no control. He was pulled over and they say, oh, you went over the speed limit. We made this law that if you go over the speed limit, we give you a ticket. And if you don't pay this ticket, even though this fucking moron cop kept saying, no, we're not arresting you for a speeding ticket. We're arresting you for the warrant. And we're like, how do you think the fucking warrant got issued because he didn't pay the ticket? So really, he's being kidnapped. And if he said, look, you have no right to kidnap me because it is extortion. It's they're kidnapping him over not paying. And he pulled out a gun to defend himself. Then he'd be dead or end up in jail. And that's crazy. First of all, the fact that most, at least here in Las Vegas and many police stations across the country want more money because they feel that, oh, we don't have enough money to fight crime, but yet they're sending out their officers to arrest people that haven't paid their tickets and haven't paid not only traffic tickets, but like I said, jaywalking tickets or any type of citation that they received. But that's exactly what it is. And how people can't see the fact that this is extortion is insane to me. So, Katy, I don't know what your thoughts are on this, but, I mean, it's extortion and kidnapping. How is it not?
I'm not going to disagree. I really don't have any words because it is tragic.
Well, because
I did. I did have a definition. Thought, like, wow, you know, you're right. They constantly complain about how they don't have enough money, you know, for more police.
I know, and you see them, it takes five of them to do one thing.
Yeah, and how many cops were there to arrest the one guy for speeding? Oh, no, excuse me, a warrant because he didn't pay a speeding ticket.
This guy, I think it was only two, so surprisingly enough. But usually they'll come with like five guys. And it depends on, you know, who it is a lot of the time. And this sounds like, I don't know where this was, but it sounds like it's in a smaller town somewhere. So maybe that's why. But I know in Las Vegas, you'll see like five cops standing around dealing with an issue that looks like, you know, one cop could be doing. Or even if they need backup, you know, two at the most. And they have like five cops there at least, sometimes more. So, I mean, you have that issue, but you have the issue of extortion, because what they say is, we're going to pass this law that says we give tickets if you're speeding. You have no say in that law. And if you don't pay it, they will kidnap you and take you off to jail. So how is that not extortion? If you look up extortion in the dictionary, it's the very definition. So do you look at, I guess I'll ask you this. Do you look at the government in many ways like the mafia, or do you totally disagree with that statement? And if so, why?
I do feel some things are necessary and some things are unnecessary. And I do think that it is motivated by money, and it's also motivated by people who want power. I do not disagree with you about that. And I don't feel that it's driven by a moral standard, you know, that for the best, which is necessary to run a society. Because there's no motivation there. Because, for example, and I'll always use, you know, even working in retail companies as an example. You know, the people who are in upper management, you know, they're driven, you know, to enforce company policy, you know, to the best of their ability. And what drives them to do that? You know, because they don't. They have a job. They don't want to lose their job. So they do, you know, what's fair. Here you have these people, you know, they're enforcing things that aren't fair. So there's no motivation to do the things that are the most fair. It just seems like everything roots back to money.
Well, part of it is because what I've brought up before is you have a monopoly. So government is a monopoly, meaning that you only have one police, meaning I know you have a police station in all these towns and whatever, but they all work for the government. You don't have competing police stations. Each town has their own police, and that's it. Where you don't have police that you can hire, okay, well, I'm going to hire these people for my protection, and you can hire these people, and you don't have any competition. So they have no incentive to get any better, to provide better customer service, to do anything good. They have no incentive. They know that they're always going to be there. No one's going to get rid of the police. And they can do whatever they want because there's no incentive. I mean, maybe certain officers, but in general, they get away with whatever they want because there's no one to fire the company. So it's like if you go to a restaurant and the service is terrible, you're not going to go to that restaurant anymore. You're going to go to a different one. And so restaurants have a motivation to treat people well, to have good food, to get better at their customer service and get better food and compete with these other restaurants, just like any other private business. But when the government runs something, which they're taking over more and more, there is no incentive because it's a monopoly. There's no competition. There's no reason for the police or anybody else to get better or to treat people better or, you know, any of those things. And it's not just the police. It's any government agency. It's anything that government does. And that's why you notice, like, government employees are mostly assholes. When you deal with government employees, in general, and I don't want to insult all government employees, but in general, their customer service skills suck because they don't really care. Because it doesn't matter. They're not going to lose business like somebody else would. So I guess getting back to before we played the clip and we were talking more about, you know, I had mentioned I don't think cars should be able that police should be able to pull people over. And you had mentioned about ways to do things without force and
violence.
Well, there, I mean, force is violent.
No.
That's the whole, how do you force somebody to do something without violence?
Well, I was talking about, for example, like your credit report. It's not violence.
Yeah, but that's not really
force. It's still force. Yeah.
Not really.
Because they're, you know, charging you, for example, they're charging you a fee or something that you didn't agree to.
Well, they're not charging you a fee because you're not going to pay it. All they're doing is they're affecting your credit score. So, but what about this? What if this comes into play as well? The credit card companies are private companies. So what if they said, no, we're not going to put tickets on our reports, then you go back to the same thing like we did with garnishing wages. You know, when they said wage garnishment, if you go to the company and the company says, no, we're not going to fucking give our employees money to you. So what if it's the same thing with credit card companies or credit agencies that they said, no, we're not. We're a private company. We're not going to put.
So how does the law get those companies to, you know, garnish their employees' wages? What does
the law they pass have? They pass the laws. But what I'm saying is the reason why companies do it, I mean, they just might not care. But it depends on the company. If it's a small company and, you know, it's like a family-oriented company or something, and your relative owns the company, and they don't have to do it. They're not going to do it. They're only going to do it because if they don't, the government will come after their company. So it's always force. No matter what it is, it's force against somebody. It may not be against you. In a way, it is indirectly, but they're always applying force against somebody to force them to do something because they're saying, well, if you don't do this, we'll put you out of business. Like, what if a company said, no, we're not going to give you the money. We're not going to garnish people's wages. Then the government would probably fine them. And they said, oh, well, we're not going to pay your fine. I mean, it just keeps going until it gets to literal force and violence. Now, some things get there quicker than others. Like a ticket obviously gets there pretty quick because you don't pay it. They issue a warrant and they use force to kidnap you. And if you try to defend yourself, obviously you're dead. So that the whole system, not just the traffic or motor vehicle system or system of travel via motor vehicles, is based on force. Of course, the whole government, and that's the point, that government is based on the threat of force and violence. But It begins that way with the whatever you want to call it, the traffic system or the motor vehicle system, because once you don't pull over. So you're supposed to pull over. You might not even know. How are you even supposed to know, really? I guess when you study for your license, it probably has it in that book. I don't remember that if a cop puts his lights on that you're supposed to pull over. But right away, it's based up on violence. Because if you don't pull over, what's going to happen? And I say that if you don't pull over, then whatever, then you don't fucking pull over. You know, let people that want to pay this money and pay taxes and consent to the system, consent to the system then. And they can consent to the benefits if they believe that there are any, like Social Security and unemployment insurance and all of these things. Although, again, unemployment, I look at differently because if the government didn't have it, you'd probably be able to get it through your work and pay a certain amount of money each month and use the money that you're not paying in taxes to do that. So we only have about 10 minutes left, but I guess what is your overall opinion on how should the traffic system, or I shouldn't say traffic because that's not the right word, the motor vehicle system or the traffic laws, how should they work in your opinion? I mean, what should be different, if anything, or should it just be how it is? Is the rights that they're violating worth the positive things that they do, if any? Because I don't think they do anything positive. I mean, you could say there's a couple things, like you mentioned reckless drivers, but how many reckless drivers are there? And how many people, as I said, just obey the laws because they don't want to get in an accident?
I mean, for the most part, if they say they supposedly don't have quotas,
they do. That's bullshit.
They do.
Because that's why it's in their budget.
I think the system is fine, actually. I think that the government is still abusing it, is abusing the people.
So you'd be okay if they showed up because you could have got arrested? Or what if they didn't even show up?
No, I'm not talking about arrest. I think that should be done away with, you know, having the officers go to your house to specifically
arrest you. Well, not go to your house, but what if they pulled you over?
See, I don't know. I don't have an opinion on that.
So you think it's okay that if they would have pulled you over and arrested you for a warrant and maybe brought you to the actual jail?
Are you going to turn my mic on? Not for what I did. Only if it was something extreme. You know, where if I cause someone harm.
So then that would be a change then.
Yeah.
So you think that the only thing that should be changed is how they handle tickets? What should they do with
that? I don't know. I haven't thought of, I wasn't prepared for this question.
Okay. So. Or they could put it on your credit report, like you said.
Yeah.
But so besides that, you think it's okay to,
like, I really don't think they should pull over people as often. I think even, like,
because even pulling people over is
based on fear. Like the speed limit. I do think that there should be a minimum. I don't know, because I don't know, like, physics. You know, where do you draw the line? Who's to judge a limit based on? I mean, these are like,
that's the problem.
Engineers,
you have government officials doing it.
But yeah, maybe it's government officials, but it's based on like knowledge of engineers.
Not
correct?
Really. No.
Well, then maybe they should. Yeah, that should be changed. It should be reevaluated. That's how I always thought.
They may have consultants. I'm sure they have consultants and stuff like that. But a lot of these things are arbitrary.
I mean, they could even do something where you, if you wanted to go 80, you could go 80 in the traveler's lane. And if you wanted to go this speed, you know, in the where you exit, what do they call that lane? You know, like
the slow lane.
The slow. I don't know. But the slow lane or whatever. Yeah, the far, like, yeah, like there should be degrees, you know, because there are people who do like to drive faster, and then you could use
caution.
Yeah,
well, they say like the right lane's like the slower lane. So
like
if
you,
you go
don't,
slower, you're
yeah,
supposed
like
to be in
you
the
don't,
right
well,
lane. On the freeway,
you're
at
not
least.
Supposed to call it the fast lane. You know, you're supposed to call it the traveler's lane. But I think yeah, like those sort of things should be reevaluated. And I mean, I guess unless you're in an accident where some it has, you know, your driving has resulted in something, you know, like an accident, then you should be penalized, but not for speeding if you're driving safe. But then again, who's to judge who can drive safe while speeding?
See,
so
and then you're just
see,
opening up a whole lot
yeah,
of things.
Yeah, but see, that's the thing, though. That's where I go back to, where do you draw the line?
Well, you
maybe
that's
why
you
these
don't.
Lines have been, you know, these limits have been made. Well, and it's how do you enforce them? I'm not saying it's okay to arrest people for jaywalking or speeding. That's not what I'm saying. I think it is a waste of time for the judge to issue a warrant. Maybe they should just issue the tickets and then it's like, okay, you owe us this much.
Well, what I'm saying is, and then again, they're saying you owe us, but really they're just making up.
Government is you know, is an organized society.
They're a mafia,
and you want to live in that society, you know, in a safe way.
Not necessarily.
You don't like
no.
You are. You ask me questions in your opinion. I feel like you kind of put my opinions down a little, but that's what I feel.
No, I mean, that's your opinion. Obviously, you're entitled to your opinion the same way that everybody else is entitled to theirs. I just disagree. So I would take it as, you know, all of these things are arbitrary. How do they come up with how much they want to charge you? How much do they come up with all of these other things? And, you know, it's all arbitrary. It's all based on whatever they want it to be, whether it's the speed limit or how much they're going to charge you for a ticket or how old you have to be to do something. So I understand the belief and the need where you feel that you need to draw a line and to have an organized society that you believe that you need these things. I just don't believe that. I believe you can have an organized society where you don't have these arbitrary things and you do not have police, period. I don't believe that there should be any traffic laws in the sense of how they are now. Now, there should be a, I guess, rules of the road type of thing where people can, you know, that you still have an organized system, but not one that is based on coercion or people are pulled over or people are, it is enforced by the police and people are kidnapped over it. And if drugs were legal, that would take away a lot of it right there. I mean, do I have all the answers on what the solution is? No, but in my opinion, it's definitely not the police or pulling people over or anything to that effect. I think there are other ways to deal with people if they're totally out of control when it comes to their driving, that it's that reckless. That's where, you know, if you have private security firms and things like that, where maybe you have an actual traffic, private traffic firms or something that just handle reckless driving, where they don't arrest anybody, they don't fine anybody, they just get them off the road. You know, again, I don't have all the answers to how things should be. And neither did, you know, people bring all this shit up all the time, but neither did the founding fathers, obviously, when they wrote the Constitution. They didn't have everything set in stone. And look what happened. Obviously, things didn't work out too well. So, yeah, I don't believe in any of these, the ability of police to pull people over or be involved in traffic laws, period, or the ability to kidnap you over anything that happens on the road, unless you intentionally try to murder somebody or something like that. That's totally different. That's just using a car as a weapon. Now that's the equivalent of murdering somebody with a gun. But that's all the time we have for tonight. We, of course, would like to thank Katy for joining us and doing a great job. Again, she usually joins us Thursday nights, but she was kind enough to join us tonight. So we will be back tomorrow with Ken Shorgen of The Daily Economist. Go to thedailyeconomist.com. And we will discuss geopolitics and the economy. So thanks, everybody.
Officers' commands, listen to what we tell you and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take it. You're forced. But at the end of the day, each and every man needs to go home safe.